Gagneja and welcome to my channel. My channel is about computer networks, security and cryptography and programming. In today's video, I will be discussing about the OSI model. It is a very, very important model because many questions from the government exams are asked from this OSI model and from the TCP/IP model. It is also very important model for clearing the interviews. And in the next video, I will be discussing about TCP/IP model. Before that, do comment. I am reading all of your comments. Do subscribe to my channel and please click on like. And OSI, as you know, that International Standards Organization was established in the year 1947. So ISO standard was created out of it. So the OSI model has got the layered architecture. There are total 7 layers in the OSI model, and I'll read it out, and there are many mnemonics on the internet which will help you in remembering it. This is a standard which was defined by the International Standards Organization. The design goals of the same were interoperability, robustness, transparency, and simplicity. The most important among them is simplicity. So many mnemonics I've already told you about this. So the layers are indirectly related to each other. And there is one mnemonic in Hindi also. It is called physical data link network, transport, session, presentation, and application. It is also called papa, dada, nana, Tata Sumo Pe Jaye. Okay, so anyways, let's start with it. Intermediate nodes are also there between the OSI model. These intermediate nodes usually involve only the first three layers of the OSI model, and there are many. Just go to Google, you will find many diagrams related to OSI model. Anyways, I have created a table. I'll explain this table to you. And each layer in OSI model has got a family of functions which is different from those of the other layers. And by defining and localizing the functionality in this manner, the designers were able to reduce the complexity or the complication of this model. But unfortunately, I'll call it, or fortunately, whatever, nowadays TCP/IP model is more popular, because everywhere you see IPv4 addresses, you see IPv6 addresses. That is a very, very interesting and beautiful topic. I'll definitely come to it in the future videos. Okay, so within the single machine, each layer calls upon the services of the layer which are below it. Okay, I'll explain it to you, don't worry. And there is also a common interface between the layers. So the as you can see that the packet goes from the physical layer, it goes to the data link layer, it goes to the network layer, and so like this, it is going through the different layers, and each interface defines what information and services a layer must provide for the layer above it. Let's start with the physical layer. As the name suggests, physical means something which is physical. Okay. Now, it is the set of functions which are required to transmit a bit stream over a physical medium. It can also be a nibble. It can also be a set of nibbles, it can also be a set of bytes, and it deals with the mechanical specifications and the electrical specifications which are there in the transmission medium. And physical layer also deals with the encoding of the bits in the form of zeros and ones. And the data rate, which you know, is the number of bits which are sent per second. So the data rate is the number of bits which are it can also be in the number of bytes which are sent per second. Then comes the synchronization of the sender and the receiver clocks. Now, why it is important? because of the security reasons. Many times if you will open the website of any military or any army of any country, it may or may not give you an error. It will state that your clock is not synchronized with our clock. Either your clock is forward or your clock is going backward. That I will cover in my future videos on security and cryptography. But for now, what I can tell you is that I am the sender and that particular military website is the receiver. So once I am digitally signing the message, I am also putting up a timestamp with that message. As a result, if the timestamp has gone into the future, it can be a security flaw. If that timestamp is in the past, I don't know, someone must have forced the message. So it is very, very important for security reasons that the sender and the receiver clocks must be synchronized. And the physical layer is connected with the connection of devices to the medium. So it can be a point-to-point configuration or the multi-point configuration. So point-to-point and multi-point configuration I'll be discussing. The point-to-point configuration will provide the dedicated link between the two devices. So the entire capacity of the channel is reserved for the communication. So most of the point-to-point configuration use the actual length of the wire to connect the two lengths, to connect the two edges. Then comes the multi-point configuration. In multi-point or multi-drop line configuration, more than two devices are sharing the same link. Coming back, the physical layer also takes care of the physical topology, whether it is a wired medium, it is a wireless medium, that is another lengthy topic, whether you are using fiber optic, you are using twisted pair, you are using copper wire, concentric copper wires. And physical layer also deals with the transmission mode, whether it is simplex, whether it is half duplex, whether it is full duplex. And physical layer is also reporting to data link layer and from the data link layer. So the next layer which I will be talking about is data link layer in the OSI model. Mind you, many times in exams, in interviews, people get confused between physical layer of OSI model and physical layer of TCP/IP model. Similarly, data link layer, network layer of OSI model and data link layer, network layer of TCP/IP model. So please don't get confused. You have to learn it no other way. And be it India or be it a foreign country like Canada, US or UK, whatever, these kind of layers will definitely help you in cracking your interviews and your placement exams. Then comes, as you can see on your screen, it is the data link layer. I'll highlight this for you. And there is my mouse, okay. So the data link layer transforms the physical layer, a raw transmission facility, to a reliable link and is responsible for node-to-node delivery. And as you can see, I have written over here, it makes the physical layer looks like it is free from errors. And what is a frame? Okay, now in the physical layer I talked about packet. Here I'm talking about the frame. The data layer divides the stream of bits into a manageable data links called the frames. Oh, I'm so sorry. In the network layer it is the frame. In the network layer it is the frame. In the physical layer it is a bit of zeros and ones only. Okay. And the physical addressing, which I have talked about, if the frames are to be distributed to different systems on the network, the data link layer adds the header to the frame to define the physical address of the sender and the receiver. Now the question is that there are different types of networks. It can be LAN, WAN, MAN, Global Area Network, Personal Area Network, I am sending a message from one type of the network to another type of the network. For that, I have to add another header to it. I'll come back to this topic. And the source address or the destination address of the frame is also considered into account. If the frame is attended for a system outside the sender's network, the receiver addresses is the address of the device that connects one network to the next. Then comes the flow control. Here it is. I am highlighting it. The flow control will make sure that the rate at which the data is being sent by the sender is lesser than the rate at which the receiver can receive it. Otherwise, what will happen is that the receiver will get overloaded with too much of information, and it can ultimately lead to congestion problems in the network. Error control, that is a very large topic. I will be coming back to it. It is cyclic redundancy check, hashing, Huffman encoding, all those things I will be discussing in the future. So it does add mechanisms to detect the error, to correct the error. Access control. So when more than two devices are connected to the same link, the data link layer protocols are necessary to determine which device has control over the given link at a time. So this data link layer is reporting to the network layer, and it is also getting the information to the network layer, and the same applies for physical layer also. So this data link layer is intermediate between physical layer and the network layer. Network layer is obviously common between all the networks. Obviously, we are studying computer networks, so this network layer, all those things will definitely come. Network layer is also in the TCP/IP model, and there are different types of protocols which are in use nowadays. For example, Apple has its own protocol called the Apple Talk, and similarly, IBM has also its own networking protocol. Coming to the network layer, it is responsible for source to destination delivery of the packet along various networks. Now, mind you, I have used the term packet over here. If the two systems are simply connected on the using a simple wire or the simple wireless network, if there are only two nodes, then there is no such a special need for network layer. But it comes into picture if we are using different types of networks, because there can be different connecting devices in between, like routers, bridges, gateways and all that. So here I will be talking about logical addressing and framing. So the physical addressing is implemented by the data link layer, handles the addressing problem locally. If the packet passes the network boundary, we need another addressing. The thing is that I am using a local area network. I am sending a packet to, say for example, another wide area network or another metropolitan area network. So for that, I have to make sure that I am, as I have written over here, it attaches an extra header so that it is able to distinguish between the source and the destination systems. Many times you must have observed that computers have got two different IP addresses at the same time. So yes, in Windows you can do it. So it explains it. Okay, routing is of various types. It is a very lengthy topic. How will you send the packet from the source to destination, which is the shortest path, which is the fastest time, which is the least cost path. And when the independent packets or links are connected to create an inter network, involving gateways or routers, and we have to send the packets to their final destination. So here the functions of the network layer is to provide the mechanism of the such kind of transmission. Okay, for example, you have got different types of network topologies also. It can be different types of network architectures also. So you want to make sure that okay, the sender IP address, the receiver IP address is same, no questions on that, but you are adding a separate mask on it to make sure that the packet reaches its destination. Then comes the transport layer. So transport layer may create a connection between the two endpoints. So if you are creating a connection between two endpoints, then you are also getting involved in the process of connection establishment, transferring of data, and termination of the connection in the form of connection release. The transport layer deals with the service point addressing. Now, what is service point addressing? See, one computer may be running different programs at the same time. It can be a Docker, it can be a server, it can be a virtual box or a virtual machine. So here the service point addressing means that one process of one computer is able to contact another process of another computer. So the network layer gets each packet to the correct computer, because one computer can have multiple ports also. So these are the different ways by which you can communicate, and obviously yes, you can do programming on ports and sockets using any of programming language of your choice. Then comes the segmentation and reassembly. For example, I am sending a book on the network. So once the receiver receives the different packets or different bits of the book, it is able to collect those parts of the book, and it is able to tell that okay, this is the page number 1, this is the page number 2, this is page number 3, and this is page number 4 of the book. Then the transport layer deals with the connection control. So what is connection control? The transport layer can be either connectionless or connection oriented. It's another lengthy topic I'll be discussing, lengthy and interesting also. Okay, it's a very good topic. I'll discuss it later on. So the connectionless transport layer treats each segment as an independent packet. Mind you, again in transport layer, I'm using the term packet. So this is another question which can come up in the interviews. And flow control, we have already discussed in data link layer, and error control also we have already discussed in data link layer. And what happens in error control is that if the packet is lost or it is damaged, so you can send a duplicate packet. But the question is, how many duplicate packets will you resend? Sending the complete message will be another wastage of time and resources. But on the other hand, if you are only sending say few megabytes, then that small discomfort can be easily ignored. Okay. Anyways, I was talking about connection control. So the connection oriented transport layer makes the connection with the transport layer at the destination machine first before delivering the packets. After all the data are transferred, the connection is terminated. Connection termination is also a very, very important thing. Many times it happens that you are creating a two-way handshake or three-way handshake, and after the communication is over, you are terminating the connection. It is done for security reasons again. Session layer. And these layers are reporting to each other. Session layer is reporting to transport layer and to the presentation layer also. The session layer is the dialog controller. It establishes, maintains, and synchronizes the interaction between communication systems. So the dialog layer means that the session layer allows two systems to enter into a common dialog. It allows the communication between two devices to take place in the form of full duplex, half duplex mode, and synchronization in context of session layer. The session layer allows a process to add checkpoints. Now the question is, I am sending one book of 900 pages on the network. there was an error in the network. Up to 400 pages were sent, but I want to make sure that a 416 page number is also sent. I am not sure, because as I have already told you, there was an error in the network. So what I will do is that from page number 1 to 400, I will ignore. From page number 401 to 900, I will resend it again on the network, so that I am 100% sure that page number 416 is delivered on the network. And yes, I am using small groups of 100 pages each, so that it is easy to send the data on the network and it is also easy to detect the errors. Then comes the presentation layer. Presentation layer deals with the encryption, compression and translation of the network data. Presentation layer reports to the application layer and it also reports to the session layer. It takes the data from the application layer, it gives the data to the session layer. It gives in the data from the session layer and it gives the data output to the application layer. So here I have written translation, as you can see on your screen. See, there are different languages in the world. Some of the examples are Hindi, Mandarin, Arabic, Russian, German, French. So all these languages have their own format of sending the information. It can be different encoding schemes. It can be ASCII encoding. It can be ADBAC encoding. It can be UTF-8 encoding. It can be UTF-16 encoding, UTF-32, UTF-64. So I have to make sure that the encoding which I am using is compatible. And there is an interoperability, as I have written over here. There is an interoperability between different encoding methods. It also deals with the compression of information. Compression ratio can be as low as 1%. It can be as high as 99%. Because once I am sending the data on the network, once I am storing the data in my hard disk, so I have to make sure that the size of the data is reduced so that it is easy to save the information. Encryption is a very large topic, and there are complete large books written on encryption and mathematics. So encryption I'll be discussing in my future videos. I'm sorry for it, but to make it short, encryption means security of the data. Encryption means converting data into a form that the eavesdropper or the hacker is not able to read it. The last layer in the OSI model is the application layer. So it enables the user, whether it is a human user or whether it is a software, to access the network. And as I have told you that it does report to and from the presentation layer, but in the end there is also a user on the another side of the application layer. So the network virtual terminal is a software version of the physical terminal, and it allows you to be log into a remote host just like a mainframe. Then comes the file transfer access method. So because of FTAM, you are able to access the files on the remote computer. You can retrieve the files, and here you are also dealing with the mail services and directory services. Mail services I'll be discussing in my future videos. It means POP, it means SMTP also. Directory services provides the distributed database sources and access for global information about various services and objects. Thank you everyone, good day, and continue watching my videos. I'll be very regular in the future videos. This time I had a gap of 3 months because of some unavoidable circumstances. And okay then, goodbye.